fountain, he really brought us the passionate understanding about the importance of the family, and also many, many important facts and figures. We're really grateful for your insightful presentation. We'd like to hear more. Maybe you can leave us your presentation here, if you could have that. Our next speaker, I'm very excited to finally have met her in person. I've met her in many, many TV programs and YouTube messages and conferences, so I'm really grateful that we could cross paths here. Dr. Gabriela Kubi, she is a sociologist. She is also a well-known writer. I'm sorry, I forgot the book, the title of your last book.
The Global Sexual Revolution, and the subtitle is Destruction of Freedom in the Name of Freedom.
That one I remember well. The Destruction of Freedom in the Name of Freedom. It's very fitting, this point, because it, indeed that's what is happening. She is also a mother of three children, and I when you Google her, you might find a Mrs. Sophia Google, Sophia Kubi, who is also very well known, and that's her daughter, of course. So, like mother, like daughter. We're grateful to have her here. Please, you have the floor, Ms. Kubi.
Thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here. Thank you for the invitation. It took some strength to get me here. And this morning I nearly didn't get on the plane, but I'm very thankful to be here in this parliament of the Czech Republic. Are there actually members of parliament here in the audience? May I just see? Could it?
Yes.
No.
Yes,
one. There's one?
Yeah.
Okay, yes, we met before. Yeah, okay. And I greet Anna Zaborska. I'm very happy to meet you here again. She is a fighter for our cause, for the European Union, for many years. She's a pillar who is not bowing to the trends of our time. I'm glad that Jan Gregor already said something about genderism. I can repeat what was said, that I'm very happy what you said, that a young person, that they understand what this time is about. And I do everything I can to get this message to young people, because in their hands is our future. And I try to give a backside, to look how did all this come about. Because it is not just an accident that our families break apart. There is political strategy behind it. It is a program which is being carried out on this, on our earth, and I'm trying to open give information to understand what is happening. That my book is not here, I do not understand. It should be offered here, somehow it didn't happen. He didn't come, but can't be helped. But if you want to get it, of course, I suppose you can get it through every bookshop or even Amazon or whatever. So, in our time, we are subjected to a new ideology which aims to dissolve the very basis of our existence, the difference between man and woman. This is the ideology of genderism. In 1951, a person which is not suspicious for Catholicism, Albert Camus, in his book The Rebel, said, quote, "The metaphysical revolt is the movement by which man rebels against his conditions of life and the whole of creation. It is metaphysical because it denies the telos, the goal of man and of creation. The slave protests against the life which he has to live within a substand. The metaphysical rebel rebels against the life which is forced on him as a human being." And this is what we are doing at the moment. Genderism claims that the identity of man and woman is a social construct which needs to be deconstructed in order that the woman can throw off the yoke of patriarchal suppression and claim her freedom, the freedom of self-design. As nature is only raw material for technological transformation, so now man himself has become raw material for his own self-design. It is a strange phenomenon that an ideology can take root and change the fabric of our existence that denies a fact that is obvious to everybody, the fact that the human being comes in two models, man and woman. George Orwell said, quote, "We have sunk so deep that the articulation of the obvious is the first duty of an intelligent man. So allow me to state the obvious. On the difference of man and woman depends our existence. Each human being has a father and a mother. During gestation, our sex is determined before our brain develops. Neurophysiology comes up as fascinating research about the difference in physiology and the workings of our brain between man and woman. The child takes the clues how to be a boy and a girl from father and mother. Psychology speaks of triangulation as essential for the development of the child. Maturity means to become father and mother, ourselves, be it biologically or spiritually, and pass on the life we have received to the next generation. Maturity means to agree to this path of nature and fulfill it. What happens if an ideology takes root in society that denies the fundamental difference of man and woman? 6 points. First, it destabilizes the identity of man and woman and creates unstable individuals who lose the last certainty of their identity after having lost religion, family, and nation as a defining element of identity. Second, it dissolves heterosexuality as the normal expression and fulfillment of the sexual drive. Three, it serves separates sexuality from fertility through contraception and abortion. Four, any kind of sexual activity is then considered as legitimate and has to be protected and is being protected by anti-discrimination laws. Five, it destroys the foundation on which marriage and family depend. It reduces procreation and thus brings forth the demographic winter which is upon most European countries. For all this to happen, the concepts of good and evil ingrained in the conscience of man must be overturned, and indeed they are overturned. Let's look back into the history of ideas, how this came about, just a very short glance. Since the French Revolution, highly learned, devoutly revered minds have contributed the philosophical and psychological ideas and cultural revolutionary expertise. To name a few, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who said goodbye to natural law and proclaimed the autonomous individual, open to self-design. Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels, who saw in the antagonism between man and woman the first-class conflict, which had to be overcome by demolishing the family. Sigmund Freud, who described man as a slave of sexual suppression. The famous sexologist Alfred Kinsey, who was a radical sadomasochist and faked service to give the impression that the transgression of sexual norms was normal in his report, The Sexuality of the Male and then of the Woman. But he faked his service, which is now known. Simone de Beauvoir, who said the famous sentence, one is not born a woman, but becomes a woman, meaning to say, female identity is constructed by society and therefore can be deconstructed and needs to be deconstructed if women want to emancipate from patriarchal suppression and enjoy the privileges and power of men and over men. This is the real battle which is going on, the power of women over men. The battle cry of Simone de Beauvoir was, get out of the slavery of motherhood. Many, many women are following this demand. The great breakthrough of the so-called sexual liberation was the student rebellion of the 1960s, fueled by the Frankfurt School. The message of Adorno, those are the professors of the Frankfurt School, Horkheimer and Marcuse, was, free yourself of repressive Christian sexual morality and thus create the paradise of a society free of domination. We're still waiting for this paradise to materialize. The spearhead of this movement is radical feminism. As in the Garden of Eden, the woman was and is at the front of the rebellion against the order of creation. Her battle cry is always the same since Eva, which is non serviam, I do not want to serve. The essence of womanhood is denied and attacked. The essence is giving life and caring for life, physically or spiritually. The radical feminists pretend to fight for still more equality for women, but in reality they are fighting against men, against women as mothers, against the child, against the family, and for the complete deregulation of sexual morality. In their mind, all women are victims, all men are predators. The revolutionary wheel was turned once more. Feminism and homosexualism married and gave birth to gender. In 1919, Judith Butler entered the scene with her book, Gender Trouble, Feminism and the Subversion of Identity. She is a celebrated professor. She gets the greatest prizes and grants. She is a member of the Rockefeller and Guggenheim Foundation. She hides her ideas in philosophical gibberish like this, quote, what best way is there to trouble the gender categories that support gender hierarchy and compulsory heterosexuality? So if you are heterosexual, it's only forced on you, yeah? The task of inquiry is to center on and decenter such defining institutions as, poor translator, as phallogocentrism, and compulsory heterosexuality. I leave out, it's too difficult for the translator. Look into Judith Butler and do not think that this is very intelligent and above you. It is nothing else but hiding the destructive message she is giving there. Because in plain language, if you translate what she's saying, it is this. There's no such thing as man and woman. While sex is a fantasy, something created by language, which we believe because it has been repeated so often, there are not two, there are many genders. In Judith Butler's view, there is no masculine or feminine being, but only a certain performance that can change at any time. For Butler, the incest taboo is one cause of phantasma, of gender identity of man and woman, and for the taboo against homosexuality. It must therefore be abolished.
One more minute.
Oh, how terrible.
It's highly interesting, but...
No, no, more time. Okay. More time. More time. More time.
Sure. Well, I have to shorten it. Look into the Yogyakarta principles if you want to see the mad definition of sexual orientation and sexual and gender identity. Well, the Yogyakarta principles, they are a totalitarian document to change, to bring about the LGBT revolution. They say your gender, your sex is dependent on your feelings, not on your biology, on your feelings. So you can have it there in writing. This is being taught at our university. We have 200 professors, all women, who teach gender queer studies at university. It is now the ideology, like dialectical materialism was under communism, which people who lived under communism know. It has the same force now on the minds of students. They must adhere to this, they must believe it. The concrete battlefronts of this cultural revolution are the systematic disjunction of sexuality from of fertility, the moral deregulation of sexuality, the legal recognition of sexual behavior and queer sexual identities like drag queens and cross dressers and leather women and what have you. The battle for the change of the once Christian value system through the media. the manipulative change of language, this is a very important point, and subversion of essential value concepts like freedom, tolerance, human rights. These big concepts are perverted and hollowed out and mean the opposite of what they actually intend. The elimination of fatherhood and motherhood, and motherhood. Yeah, we are aware of fatherhood now. Motherhood is at stake also by raising small, tiny babies in daycare institutions, and maybe the most important front of the battle, the sexualization of children beginning in kindergarten through obligatory sex education, which means teaching them masturbation from babyhood onward, preparing them for the first time, teaching them that family is a multitude of things, and you choose what kind of family you have, and you choose what kind of sexual orientation you have. Look at the standards for sexuality education in Europe. You find it in the internet. It's a document by the World Health Organization and the German institution, BZGA, where these things are beautifully outlined. You can look at it and see what the World Health Organization intends for our young people. Most parents don't want this, but they look away. School curricula force acceptance of different gender identities on children from the first to the last year of school, teaching them acceptance of the lifestyle of homosexuals, bisexuals, transsexuals, and offering these lifestyles for choice. Homosexual couples go into the schools to help puberty, boys in puberty, to come out. Why are not parents sent into the schools to teach children how one can live a family, because this is what they want? Surveys show they want family. Why do we not teach them how one builds a family? This is what we should do. Every one of us has a responsibility for that. For some countries, homeschooling is a sort of niche for Christians. In Germany, it is forbidden. If in Germany, parents, there are fewer dozen cases, take out the children out of the sex education, they're put into prison and the children into custody. Yeah, so homeschooling is not, we have to fight that it's possible, but it's not a solution to all this. All of this is the program of the United Nations and the European Union, the US government under Obama, billionaire foundations like Bill and Melinda Gates and Rockefeller, global NGOs like International Planned Parenthood. But there is growing resistance in many countries. In Hungary, has adopted a Christian constitution. In France, you heard it already, a mass movement has sprung up, Manif pour tous. In the European Union, in the parliament, there is resistance, and some of these decisions put to the parliament were rejected, which is completely new. The pillar of resistance on this earth so far was the Catholic Church in its high level, not necessarily at the low levels. I'm very sad to tell you, and I am deeply shocked from the news today, that this pillar is beginning to wobble at its highest place. We have the Bishop Synod in Rome at the moment. They have their first briefing of what has been talked during this last week, and they say, welcome homosexuals into the church. They have a very special charisma for the church. It's okay to cohabitation is okay. Look into the news, you will find it. So this pillar of the Catholic Church is not standing fast. And that is me, as a convertment to Catholic faith, is a really, really very disturbing news. Still, let us fight the good battle, whether we are successful or not. It is worth it fighting. Thank you very much.
Take that to heart, that what is happening, and face this reality. It is really a tough situation. That doesn't mean that we should give up hope, but I think we should take take it more seriously. And one of the reasons why we hold this conference is also to, especially in the parts of Eastern Europe, and our, actually our next presenter will be from Czech Republic, Dr. Juraj Lajda. He is actually the one who brought this conference together with members of the here. We're very grateful that you managed to bring this here. Dr. Juraj Lajda is the Secretary General of UPF in Czech Republic. He's a publisher, and something that is important for us to know from Western Europe, he was a political prisoner at the time of communism. So shows that he must be a man of character. So please, you have the floor, Dr. Lajda.
Děkuji moc za krásné uvedení. Děkuji paní Kubi za její vydávný projekt a mě to jenom potvrzuje v tom, že moje snaha dostat ji do Prahy nebyla zbytečná. Myslím si, že ji můžeme ještě jedno zatleskat za tento projekt. Vážené dámy, vážení pánové, milí přátelé, je mi skutečně velkou ctí, že můžu tady promluvit na této konferenci, když jsem organizátorem. Dlouho jsem o tom přemýšlel, poslední týden, to byl takový můj headache, jestli udělat tento příspěvek nebo ne. Ale uvědomil jsem si, že jsme v Praze, jsme v bývalé komunistické zemi a je potřebné tento hlas, aby tady zazněl. Jinými slovy, aby zazněla perspektiva z tohoto prostředí, z kterého my vycházíme. Bylo tady mnoho vynikajících příspěvků a nechci se opakovat v mnoha věcech, ale chci jenom dát takovou malou reflexi, jak vnímáme situaci po druhé světové válce v naší společnosti. Možná to bude pro kolegy ze západu trošku kritika, ale myslím si, že každý si může v tom najít to své. Chtěl bych ještě uvést jednu věc, že není jednoduché mluvit o paní Kubi, takže promiňte, jestli vás to nenaplní, ani příspěvek. Chtěl bych navázat na jednu zajímavou myšlenku z předchozího příspěvku paní Kubi, která říkala, že v Německu 200 profesorů, tedy žen, učí gender, ideologii a v pozadí je stejná síla, jako když se učil marxismus. Prosím vás, toto já můžu tady na půdě této sněmovny prohlásit, že to, co řekl, je autentické. Já jsem to zažil. Jako politický ideolog v 70. letech jsem zažil tento komunistický režim, ale hlavně tu ideologii, to, co jsme tenkrát mohli a nemohli. Studoval jsem lingvistiku a proto vím, jakou hodnotu má terminologie a slova a jazyk. Dokonce si vzpomínám, v roce 73. jsem četl jeden lingvistický článek o Severní Koreji a to jenom potvrzují slova zjištěná před chvíli, kde měli v lingvistice takový postup, že když vymažou slovo Bůh nebo nebesa, tak jednoduše to nebude existovat. A to bylo z pohledu lingvisty, to byl odborný lingvistický článek. Já se teďka dostanu k předmětu svého příspěvku. Chtěl bych srovnat hodnotový systém západu a východu po druhé světové válce. Co se dělo? Podíváme-li se na dějiny Evropy a západní civilizace, vidíme dva myšlenkové proudy, které se vzájemně prolínají a umíjí. Na jedné straně máme hebraismus a na straně druhé helenismus. Hebraismus vycházel z židovsko-křesťanské tradice a usiloval o duchovní a morální hodnoty, formuloval hodnotový systém a vymustil demokracii ve 20. století jako pilíř demokratického politického režimu. Na druhé straně helenismus měl oporu v řecké kultuře, v renesanci, zabýval se přírodou, přírodními zákony, vědeckým bádáním, uměním, materiálním světě, materiálními hodnotami. Teď na jedné straně máme tu tradici ateistickou, která se zabývá duchovnými hodnotami a snaží se formovat. Na druhé straně máme helenistickou tradici, která se zabývá nicméně fyzickým světem, materiálním světem a snaží se formovat podobně hodnotový systém. Neříkám, že musí být v konfliktu. Je to jako mysl a tělo člověka, které by mělo být v harmonii. Ale vždy nastala disharmonie a společnost tím trpěla. V 18. století se stal základem helenismus pro francouzskou revoluci a později zdrojem marxismu a komunismu. Zaznamenáváme tedy tyto dva myšlenkové proudy, které ovlivňovaly vývoj Evropy, tedy proud duchovní a materiální. Dnes to máme v podobě té, že mluvíme o sekularizaci Evropy a ztrátě morálních a duchovních hodnot. To je takový malý exkurs do historie. Podívejme se na situaci po druhé světové válce. Svět se rozdělil na dva nepřátelské tábory, dva rozdílné světy. Demokratický a komunistický. Zkusme se nyní podívat, jak se tyto dva světy, oddělené ve své podstatě a vzájemně neslučitelné, vyvíjeli až do dnešního dne. Mluvíme o přítomnosti, ale musíme si říct i ten vývoj. Komunismus. Komunismus je materialistická a ateistická ideologie, člověku nedává svobodu ani zodpovědnost. A kolektiv je nadřazený jednotlivci. Demokracie je způsob vládnutí, správa věcí veřejných, kdy stát má vytvářet prostředí pro svobodný projev každého jednotlivce a do života jednotlivce by měl zasahovat co nejméně. Nejvyšší hodnotou je zodpovědnost a samozřejmě svoboda. To je nejvyšší hodnota demokracie. Tento systém byl postaven na židovsko-křesťanském hodnotovém systému a je s ním neodmyslitelně spjat, pokud má správně fungovat. Dalo by se tedy předpokládat, že usiluje o ideál člověka, který zobrazuje boží obraz imago Dei. Od 50. let minulého století se tyto dva systémy rozvíjí osobitě o vzduší studené války. Co se děje dál? V 60. letech 20. století, a tady nastávají změny, dochází na západě k sexuální revoluci díky subkultuře hnutí hippies, která se postupně šíří po celém světě a pokračuje v 70. a 80. letech. To je vývoj na západě. Volná láska se stává pro mnohé vyznávaným životním stylem a ze vztahy mezi muži a ženami se začíná experimentovat. Tato skutečnost však začíná zásadně narušovat systém zažitých morálních hodnot jakožto pilířů skutečně svobodné demokratické společnosti a s ním spojený i koncept tradiční rodiny. Sexuální revoluci v 60. letech. Statisticky se to dá ukázat na tom, na minulé konferenci, kdy jsme dělali podobné téma o rodině s kolegy z Německa, jedna řečnička právě na základě statistik uváděla, že v 19. století byl průměr, tedy počet narozených dětí 5,4 v Německu. Dneska po 140 letech je to 1,4. Možná v těch 50. letech ta rodina ještě, jak řekl, fungovala jako základ demokratického systému na západě. Ve jménu svobody, tedy v těch 60. letech, se hledá ospravedlnění pro všeobecný úpadek morálních a rodinných hodnot a tradiční rodina se začíná rozpadat. Tento trend se stupňuje v 90. letech a nakonec viditelně vyústil tzv. Gender mainstream ideologie. Západní společnosti v oblasti rodinných hodnot dostává postupně do znaku. Podívejme se na vývoj východních zemí. Východní země v té době tento trend nezachytávají. Stává se pro ně druhořadným či přehlíženým, protože jejich hlavní prioritou je především vymanění se z totalitního režimu a hledání svobody. Třeba se to musíme porozumět, kdyby měl tabulku, tak jsem musel udělat dva takové vývojové linky. V komunistických zemích se řeší svoboda. Neřešíme sexuální revoluci v té době. Východní země od 60. let minulého století zhlíželi západní zemí jako svému nedostižnému vzoru. Zatímco v 60. letech probíhala na západě sexuální revoluce, ve východních zemích lidé toužili po svobodě, po svobodě projevu, po náboženské svobodě, možnosti cestování a tak dále. Podívejme se na rok 1968. Co se dělo na východě na západě? Na západě došlo k revoltě studentů proti establishmentu. V Německu byť hnutí Rudy Dučke nebo ke studentským nepokojům v Paříži. My jsme ale tady na východě v roce 68 vkládali naději do socialismu s lidskou tváří. My jsme neřešili sexuální otázky a toužili po svobodě a demokracii. Řešili jsme základní otázky lidské svobody a společenského systému, který mi tuto svobodu garantoval. Naděje pražského jara, které spjato s Českou republikou, s Československem tehdejším, byly přerušeny pádem vojsk Varšavské smlouvy. Poté nastalo období 21. normalizace. Od roku 68 se dostáváme do roku 1989. Komunismus nakonec padl. Přišla vytoužená svoboda, ale s ním bohužel i morální úpadek a zmatek hodnot ze západu. Jako příklad lze uvést první zahraniční časopis, který se hned po revoluci etabloval, a tím byl Playboy. Za posledních 25 let jsme pomalu vystřízlivěli z představ o svobodě a hodnotovém systému západu. Ve jménu svobody se nám opravdová svoboda stále více vzdala. Momentálně se západ i východ setkávají na křižovatce, pokud jde o rodinné hodnoty. Přičemž každý systém se do tohoto bodu, nebo do této, na tuto křižovatku dostal z jiného. Západní společnost možná v tomto ohledu zašla ještě dál. Diskutuje se o převládajícím sekularismu a ztrátě duchovních a morálních hodnot, jak se už zmiňovalo. To samozřejmě ovlivňuje pojetí tradičních rodin, kdy se jejich účel a smysl ztrácí. Komunismus jsme zažili snahy o zrovnoprávňování žen již v 50. letech. Ženy byly oslavovány jako jeřábnice, dojičky nebo traktoristky. Byla snaha, aby ženy za každou cenu pracovaly, děti se dávaly do věcí. Společnost měla dohlížet na její výkon. Měřitelem hodnoty člověka se stal jeho výkon a pracovní efektivita. Toto všechno bylo součástí marxistické ideologie, která chtěla vytvořit nového člověka a novou společnost. Přetváření společnosti bylo zároveň výrazem odmítnutí demokratických hodnot západu a chtěla komunistická společnost ukázat se lepší než západní, která byla založena na tradičních rodinách, kdy se o výchovu dětí starala rodina a matky nemusely jít finanční důvody do zaměstnání, protože otec živitel rodiny vydělal dost a aby rodiny užili. Je však zarážející, a už to mám končit, že podobné myšlenky týkající se rodiny, které jsme my na východě již zažili, a i o jejich nesmyslnosti jsme se na vlastní kůži přesvědčili, najednou začínají přicházet ze západu. Jsou představovány jako moderní koncepce pro vývoj společnosti, které překonávají tzv. Staromódní představy o rodině. Ptejme se však, zda je to možné tak, a pokud snad ano, k čemu byly ty všechny oběti za komunismu, tolik politických vězňů, kteří usilovali o svobodu a dobrou společnost, když se po jeho pádu vlastně dostávali do stejné situace. Je to o to závidnější, že tyto ideologie přicházejí ze západu, který byl naším vzorem a prezentují se jako nový a moderní politika. Momentálně stojíme před stejnou otázkou bez ohledu na to, jestli jsme ze západu nebo východu. Jaká má? Co můžeme udělat pro to, aby se rodina ve své podstatě zachovala úplně? Aby skutečně mohla být základní stavební jednotkou zdravé, prosperující a svobodné společnosti, jak na západě, tak i na východě a v celém světě. Je potřeba překonat tento zmatek v hodnotovém systému, převzít zodpovědnost a udělat všechno pro to, aby se role a hodnota tradičních rodin pro společnost posílila. A je nutné a nanejvýš aktuální, aby se prorodinné organizace, hnutí a podobně v tomto úsilí spojili. Jedině tak bude ve společnosti méně problémů a může po všech stránkách prosperovat. Máme dvě možnosti. Buď vytvořit rodinu jako zobrazení původního ideálu imago Dei, božího obrazu, anebo rodinu jako důsledek sexuální revoluce, potažmo devalvace morálních hodnot. Hodně zdaru, při vaší volbě. Děkuji za pozornost.
have to take what you're saying to us, especially in the West. What we are cooking there, we don't want to serve you as a special lunch. So right now we go to our fourth and last speaker, last but not least. Very happy, and Mr. Christian Hausmann is here. He is the Vice President of the Christian Democratic Party in Stuttgart. He's equally also Secretary General of UPF Germany. And he is, what qualifies him to speak about family, father of four children. So that's about three or four? Sorry.
Three. Correct you, yes.
Okay, thank you. Christian Hausmann, you have the floor, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, and welcome to all of you. Thank you for holding on and trying to take in as much as possible, as I did in this rich morning session. I hope it's rewarding for you as it was for me. I can assure you I will not make extensive use of the opportunity to speak, as politicians are sometimes inclined to do. I was very intimidated by the time limit that was given. So I really made a short speech. You can enjoy a short speech, okay? And what I can do is only give a few points to show you where the discussion is going on in Germany at the moment. And I may give you some key words or some arguments so that you can know where you want to stand in this debate and in this discussion. After the Second World War and the impact of Second World War, many things were done right also in Germany. And one of the things that we are proud of is the Constitution and the basic law of the Federal Republic of Germany, which you have to understand was a reaction of the experience of totalitarian systems, fascism but also communism. So, if you look at the Constitution only, it looks everything is honky-dory in Germany. Everything is fine. I think someone quoted the Constitution already this morning, especially Article 6. Sounds great. The paragraph 1, 2, and 3 are great. Paragraph 1, marriage and family shall enjoy the special protection of the state. Great. Paragraph 2, the care and upbringing of children is the natural right of parents, and the duty primarily incumbent upon them. Great. The state shall watch over them in the performance of this duty. Okay. Then paragraph 3. The children cannot be separated from their legal parents against the will of their legal parents without a legal ground, unless the legal parents fail in their responsibilities or the children are threatened with neglect. So that sounds good and is good. But I have to also admit and say that recent legislation and policies do not do too much good to the family, also in Germany. I'm afraid to not bring better news. The former Minister of Labour, Norbert Blüm, called this threat that he sees to the family with an interesting term. He talked about Entfunktionalisierung by outsourcing. I hope you understand that. In English, it's defunctionalization by outsourcing. Frau Kubi used the term hollowing out. So, family, the function of the family is outsourced, and the family loses its meaning in that way. For example, by the outsourcing of the education of children, and consequently later on also outsourcing the care for the elderly. So then what is left from the family if they only meet in the evening shortly before they go to bed? So family becomes in the end a sleeping place, like a hostel where tired people meet in the evening and say good night to each other. Dogma in Germany, and this dogma is that of the double income family. That's the great thing, double income family, in all respect. I'm not against income, double income, but it is the double income family, and that's dominating all forms of media and unfortunately also the majority of the political area. Both parents, according to this dogma, must work full time. Therefore, children must be out of the house all day, as long as possible, even before they are 1 year old. Breaks my heart sometimes to hear that. Yeah? They should grow up in day nurseries, all day kindergartens, and all day schools. And to make it sound very attractive, we call these places Kita Einstein. You know, so that the parents at least believe their children will become Einstein afterwards. It is even disputed if an encouragement of parental interference with the education is beneficial at all. You wouldn't expect that, but the OECD organization, very well known, is saying, well, the interference of parents with children education is maybe not beneficial at all. Recently I heard even a statement, kind of that, from the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung Foundation, you know, you wonder. We are about to realize a demand of the famous feminist Simone de Beauvoir that was already quoted, but I quote her again because that's a very radical sentence of her. She said, no woman, listen to that, no woman should be allowed to stay home to take care and educate her children. Full stop. Wow. The majority of politicians supported by the media want exactly that at the moment, namely the upbringing of children as a public responsibility. That's better for the children, that's better for the state, that's better for the pension, that's better in all respects, they're trying to tell us. The one member of parliament said we have to maybe try to understand the motivations for this way of thinking. We should not marginalize these people, and maybe it's well-meaning what they're suggesting. Yeah, equalization of women, equal opportunities. Okay, but for some parties, it's really programmed. The state is better than the parents. The moment the Social Democrats always had this ideology. Great Social Democrats, but in Germany, one very famous Social Democrat, now he's mayor of Hamburg, one of the big cities. He used to be the Secretary General of the Social Democratic Party, said the state should have the air sovereignty or air supremacy over the cribs. Military term. State has to have the air supremacy over the children's beds. Yeah? That was his demand, and then people thought that's right. And today it's like this, if you don't agree with that, if you might express as a mother, but I wish to see my little children grow up, I wish to take care of these children myself, and maybe even I don't have an academic degree, I might do it very well, maybe even as good as the others, you are object of ridicule. You are called, considered old-fashioned, unprogressive, backwards. You might even get insulted. Unfortunately, that's a reality, you know? Now, when we wonder about the role of government, should government not allow at least freedom of choice and be respectful about people that choose to have a different life concept, so that people can live the way they want? Shouldn't we better ask, or the governments better ask, what is it that people want? Do they care about what people want in this respect? Or shouldn't they ask what is the best for children? Yeah, they should, but they do not. Of course, various life concepts exist among the population. A survey, by the way, in Austria very similar to Germany, about 2 years ago, a survey in Austria was taken, and then a big blow for the feminists. In this survey, over 50% of the women under the age of 29 could imagine themselves as stay-home mother if their husband earned enough for the family. If their husband earned enough, I can imagine myself stay home. Why not? It's not too bad taking care of the children. Some parties don't like. The Green Party in Germany wouldn't like that at all. They would not publish this survey. And since they ideologically convinced it's better if the children are raised outside. So a member of the Green Party in Austria, in response to this survey, said the demand for childcare away from the family must be generated through supply. You have to offer it so that the demand is generated. Because normally, naturally, you, as a mother, you want to be, I think, with the children. Also, surveys taken regularly in Germany have shown that 70% of the women would enjoy working only part-time and take care of the children themselves in the first years. But it doesn't change at the moment the dogma of the politician. And of course, the children, they do not ask the children. If they would ask the children, what would you like? Yeah, they would say, I would like more time with mama and papa. Yeah? So politics are largely oriented on the ideological concept of a double income marriage and not so much on the wishes of still the majority of the population. The reasons for that, partly also Mrs. Kubi explained it, are partly ideological in nature, from Green Party, feminist ideas, or the influence of the economy that has a need for women as labor force. As you know, we have this demographic situation. In Germany, we do not have enough labor force for the economy. And they think that good educated, well-educated women, let's have them work and not take care of their children. And so laws are made accordingly to this ideological and concept and demand of the economy. For example, there is an individual legal claim that now families have against the government to childcare from birth on. So, if you say, I want that the state takes care of my child from zero to, you have the right, the state has to provide it, they made this law. Now this place costs 1,200 euro a month. Okay? It costs about 1,200 euro a month. So you would think that
one,
if the mother...
1 minute.
Okay, sorry. If the parents say, I want to do it, I do it for half. I stay at home, I do it for half. But you don't get it. Only one party was there that said, let's give something to those mothers that want to stay at home. Let's give them at least 150 euros. The Christian Democrats in Bavaria. 150 euros for the mother that stays at home. Then all the parties inside women that stay at home, they would misuse the money, they would buy flat screens for that money instead of giving it to the children, they would go for booze and whatever. Horrible. Yeah. So it's a disparity. Then also the right of pension benefits from gainful employment if you compare it to the benefits from child care at home. You need to raise 15 children to have the same pension rights as a cashier on in the supermarket. 15 children. So, as a quotation from the former minister president of Baden-Württemberg, Erwin Teufel, from the Christian Democrats and Party I'm from, he said, these days nothing has value unless you can say how much it is worth in currency. If it is not possible, it has no value. Therefore, the education of the family has no worth, even though everything depends on it, and is the foundation of the society. And then he said, one of my fellow countrymen and national economist, Friedrich List, said 160 years ago, the raising of swine goes into the gross national product. The raising of children does not. Yeah? If you raise swine, oh, you're the euro, because it adds to the national growth. But the raising of children, the unemployed, who said unemployed? And then our, let me finish that, and then I'm assuming I'm gone. Our minister, family minister from the Social Democrats, Frau Schwesi, she said in an interview, yeah, of course you can raise your children yourself, but I have to warn you of the consequences. that she said. And what does she mean? Did she mean by consequences? She meant the consequence for your pension benefits. You can do that, but in the end you get no pension, and the consequence in case there is a divorce. You stay at home, you receive your divorce, yeah. Where do these consequences come from? Have they fallen from the sky? Are they natural laws? No, of course not. They're not fallen from the sky, they're not natural laws. They were made by governments. Yeah? So, what else? What else? What will be the consequences of the deterioration, destruction of the fundamental biological, social, spiritual unit of the family? What will happen with our family that this has secured the life? The citizens will become prey of the state. prey of the state. It's high time to change direction and practice family mainstreaming. Also, we see the countries that have been first in doing that, they harvest no good results. Sweden, the first cause for teenage death is suicide. Yeah? So the Sweden has the unhappiest young children, and they've been the first to do it. I close with Plato. Who quoted Plato this morning? You can go quote this Plato. So Plato, he said, first you ought to have an idea of what is the best before you can model a compromise according to time and situation. If you look for the second or next best, everything will be lost. It's time for family mainstreaming. It's time to be clear of what is the best. Thank you very much.